to The Report Card with Nat Malkus, the education podcast from the American Enterprise Institute. According to a recent study by Common Sense Media, teenagers spend an average of 9 hours per day on screens, and kids 8 to 12 spend 6 hours a day. That's, of course, outside of school and outside of sleeping. That's a lot of screen time. We should be concerned about these, but today we want to talk about what screen time means for even younger kids. And to discuss this, we have two excellent guests. Jenny Radesky is an assistant professor of pediatrics at the University of Michigan Medical School and was one of the principal authors of the 2016 American Academy of Pediatrics Digital Media Guidelines for Young Children. So we talk with Jenny about what those guidelines mean and the dangers and benefits screen time pose for kids. After we talk with Jenny, we talk with Erika Christakis, an early childhood educator and author of The Importance of Being Little, What Young Children Really Need from Grown-Ups. We talk with Erika about, well, parents and how they use screens and how their screen time use can be particularly important for developing young minds. Without further ado, let's welcome Jenny Radesky. Jenny Radesky of the University of Michigan and C.S. Mott Children's Hospital. Welcome to The Report Card.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, so you are a principal author on the American Academy of Pediatrics Guidelines for Screen Time Use for Kids. Can you give me a thumbnail of what those guidelines are?
Yes. So we released those in 2016. We really wanted to update our research review of the evidence,
right?
Because the iPhone and other mobile devices were released in 2007, and then the iPad in like 2010 or 2011. So it was the nature of children's digital media environment had changed so drastically that a lot of people were concerned that the prior AAP guidelines didn't fully apply or capture the way kids were using media.
And those AAP guidelines that preceded the 2016 revision came out in
2011 and 2013. There have been different ones for different ages.
So let me just ask one clarifying question before we get into exactly what the guidelines are. Are the guidelines meant to be a upper bound? Like, this is the fence and you shall not go past it? Or is it, this is about where you should be in terms of your screen time? I'm just wondering, how should we digest those guidelines?
We really wanted to make the messaging a bit more flexible, because one criticism of prior guidelines was that a one-size-fits-all approach is not going to work in the very varied families in the United States. So what we decided to do was, in addition to our guidelines, we created a family media use plan online tool that really asked parents to be intentional, like proactive. Think through the way you want to use media. Don't just grab for the device, you know, anytime you're feeling stressed out or you want your child to be quiet.
Right.
Think about it beforehand. Think about the content you want. Think about the times of day that you want to unplug and be able to single task on your kids. Right. And so we were really trying to put the knowledge and the ideas in the hands of the parents so they could make flexible decisions about what's best. So there, it wasn't really like a, here's the ideal, do all this.
Right.
Otherwise, you're a fail. You're as a parent.
Sure.
It was really trying to say, this is important. As media becomes even more pervasive and easily accessed, and we're carrying it around in our pockets all the time, we need to think about this and plan it out and talk about it with your kids.
And we'll definitely link to that tool in the show notes so people can find it. Which reminds me, I still haven't gotten to the guidelines. So the guidelines, they're for three age groups, right? So we have, I believe it's under 18 months, just nothing but video chats, right?
Yeah. We use the word avoid. Because
avoid.
You know what?
Because
there are going to be times you put your 9-month-old in front of a 20-minute video. And that's okay, because you're a parent and you need to relax. Then from 18 months to 5 years, we recommended limiting to an hour of entertainment screen media a day.
And that's entertainment screen media.
Yeah, that's not video chatting.
Right.
That's not you working together on like a silly puzzle or something, or working on a recipe where you're reading the recipe off of the screen. You know, this is like sit back, watch a few episodes on Netflix.
Just enjoy yourself.
You know, we wanted parents to realize there's so much more your kid needs to do to really be mentally and emotionally prepared for kindergarten. Don't buy the marketing that these apps are essential. So we did say there's no pressure to introduce tablets or other digital media at an early age. Kids will catch on.
Right.
Don't worry about it. You're not putting your kid behind.
They learn to swipe incredibly quickly.
Well, these user interfaces are so intuitive.
Yeah.
Like, there's no problem with holding off and being a little bit more low tech if you want to. If you want to be a parent that's using tech with your kid, make it a shared activity, because these are handheld little computers. We were realizing that it's much more likely that parents and kids are using them in separate rooms,
right,
in parallel, not engaging around them the way that we would do, you know, around a movie or around the TV when we only had one TV in the living room. Another new addition to the AAP guidelines was we asked parents to be more mindful about their own tech use around kids, because kids learn very didactically from us of like, you can only use it for an hour, you can not use it before bedtime. They learn from our rules, but they also learn more informally by watching our behavior,
They learn to use it whenever they can get away with it.
Sure. They learn that it's this desired object that we're all like responding to, all of its pings and notifications. Right. So if parents could be more self-aware of when they're letting their own mobile device use or media use invade times that you might have otherwise had quality downtime with your family, then that'll help role model for kids that they should do the same.
What about school-age children? So school-age children, right, if you get six and up, you can really spend a lot of time on a lot of screens.
Yes.
So what are the recommendations in that range?
The recommendations were to make sure you are building out your day with all the other things you need to get done before you put media use in there. And I'm not talking about homework-based media use. I'm talking about you got to get the right amount of hours of sleep. That is so crucial for kids. Attention, emotional well-being, you know, obesity risk, all these other things. You've got to go to school and then do the meaningful work that school may assign to you. We want you to be on a sports team or a chess club or some other community activities where you are creating meaningful connections with other kids. We want you to have a family meal where you are connecting with the other people in your family. And then the time left over, sure, do the sort of media that is creative, connecting, positive. There were studies that we reviewed for the older children that showed if you're connecting over social media about meaningful issues or in a really positive way with other people, that's not negative. You know, it's really the kids who were using it for more spewing all their negative emotions or interacting more negatively with other kids or tearing other people down. That's more associated with negative emotional outcomes.
So Twitter. Just kidding.
Yeah.
And for teenagers?
So for teenagers, the guidelines are mostly about what to do. There's not a lot of don't do this, don't do this. It's really about choose media that is pro-social, that's helping you connect with new ideas, connect with new people. Don't media multitask. That is one don't that's in there because your attention's going to be split and you're not going to be as good as anything you're doing.
People cannot multitask.
And for all families across all ages, it was finding some unplugged times.
And no screens in the bedroom, right?
Yes.
That's an important one, I think.
That's really hard to do.
Yeah.
I'll be honest. I have families in clinic that are like, I cannot stop this. This is how he falls asleep. And that's, I wrote a commentary for Common Sense Media when their last census came out. They do like a census every 2 years kind of screen media use in the U.S., and I kind of felt like we're at a point, at least from a public health standpoint or a pediatric standpoint, where we have a guideline that we really want families to do, and they just feel like they can't do it, and they feel bad about it.
I have a question about what do we really know and how do we know? And there's two ways to ask this. One, what kind of studies are out there on this? And number two, this is a fast-moving river. So 10 years ago, the App Store opened, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's mind-blowing. And Facebook had 100 million users 10 years ago. Now they have 2.4 billion active users, and not all of them are bots. So, the question that I have is, in such a rapidly changing tech environment, how confident are we in what we know about the benefits for kids?
I think that's the most frustrating part of my research life, is that I will think of an idea, I write the grant, I submit the grant, months later I get feedback on the grant, months later I resubmit it. If it gets funded the following year and I do the study and then I publish it, that's like 3 or 4 years between an idea that motivated me and actually getting it out to the public. And we need a much faster pace and more kind of rapid response research infrastructure. And I've talked about this with folks from the NIH when I was on their strategic planning committee. I've talked about it with the senators who are putting forth the Children and Media Research Act, the bill that was introduced over the summer from Senator Markey's office. So those could potentially change the way we do research about media to make sure we're still doing quality research that's asking really insightful questions and isn't sloppy.
Right.
Because there's always a possibility for bias and sloppiness
in this
research.
Sure, sloppy and fast isn't better than accurate and slow.
But I know in my clinical practice, I'm a developmental behavioral pediatrician, that families are asking me questions that I don't have the answers to. They're asking me questions about YouTube. There's very little YouTube research out there. They're asking me questions about Alexa and Siri and all these other virtual assistants yeah. that have AI capabilities that we don't have a lot of research on right now. So it's frustrating to not be able to keep up. I just gave a talk at the American Academy of Pediatrics National Conference where I was trying to help pediatricians just anticipate what sort of questions they might get, or at least give them a framework of, is this new technology displacing the other stuff you really like doing with your kids? Is it actually supporting you in giving you more cool ideas of what to do with your kids? You know, like podcasts over Alexa or Google Pod, you know, when you get to listen to cool stories together and it generates conversation, that's an added plus.
Sure.
And families should feel like they have the right to evaluate what's making my parenting life feel more fulfilled and what part of technology is making my parenting life feel harder. For some parents, they say autoplay drives them crazy because their child is sitting there and there's a visual countdown of like when the next episode's coming on and yep. they have a tantrum.
Plus one from this parent.
Exactly.
Anyway, go ahead.
Or having the sort of persuasive design, the sort of engagement-based design that's embedded in a lot of kids' apps that's like, here, collect these tokens and you get this confetti and you get these balloons every time you do something wonderful, which isn't like real life. In real life, you don't get confetti and balloons when you do something right.
It's efficient in Skinnerian reactions.
Oh, yeah. And it works.
Yeah,
boy, does it work. So you get kids who are like, no, don't take it away.
Sure.
This is so satisfying. So I'm trying to, even though we don't have a ton of research on that yet, at least give parents some concepts to work by of like, if this doesn't feel good to you, you don't have to feel pressure to have your kid use it. Even in 2016, when we wrote the AAP guidelines, we were basing most of our recommendations on research on TV and video games. A little bit of social media research had come out by that point, but it was frustrating to not be able to give really up-to-date guidance. And so we had to give some that felt like we were stretching it a little bit. Like we had had two studies on children's use of mobile devices during daily routines or to keep them occupied or keep
right.
them calm. Both of those showed that toddlers who use mobile devices more to calm them down, to keep them quiet, to keep them occupied through daily routines, had worse social and emotional development.
Right.
So in toddler terms, that's more tantrums, more trouble sharing, you know, just more defiant behavior.
Any
more
changes on executive function, ability to plan, that sort of thing?
No one's tested that yet.
That
I'm doing
is...
a study right now that is using executive functioning measures. But self-regulation is very tied into those social emotional characteristics.
Right.
It's very tied into executive function. So we, based on those two studies, did recommend, you know, parents, please try not to use mobile devices as the main way you calm your kid down. Your child needs to learn how to identify their distress, think about what to do about it, you know, connect with a trusted adult who might help them understand their feeling and problem solve around it, rather than just having a tantrum or being distracted by a video. So that felt like, okay, we're basing this recommendation on two studies, but actually people really appreciated it because it spoke to what they were seeing in clinical practice and it spoke to what parents were feeling conflicted about. Nothing works as well as distracting your child with a mobile device.
Well, you know, I am very curious about what the different kinds of media are. And if we just stick to handheld screens, mobile devices, even on there, there's such a wide array of
mm-hmm.
apps. Now, the problem that I find is that what a lot of parents seem to want to do is use this to hold their child's attention for a little while they are shopping, you know, for reasonable, you know, it's a good babysitter. A lot of the apps that are used for that are free
mm-hmm.
and they are designed to be addictive. They have these little reward systems that are incredibly effective on adults, much less little kids. Do we know what the distribution of kids' time is along these things versus, you know, the PBS kids apps that are designed to teach words and help with numeracy? Do we even know?
No, I'm collecting that data right now. So it's a
right.
great question, just describing. We are using apps that run on either Android or iOS mobile devices,
right.
and then we get output about what apps we're running. So we can really see, was this child using PBS
right.
kids, or were they using like EduKitty or
right.
some other app that's
right.
free and on the App Store and has, you know, ads in it.
Or even one without
yeah.
EDU anywhere.
No.
Those are the worst.
Right.
Candy Crush is only so educational, right?
Only a little bit.
yeah.
I mean, yeah, I've interviewed a lot of parents about their children's technology use. And I had one mom say, well, at least it's teaching him to be a consumer of someone who's always expecting to get candy and the next level and the next thing. And And so I thought that was interesting. Again, it's that informal teaching that we're doing to our kids of like, yeah, this is play. This like very constrained, constructed thing in an app that's going to reward you for everything you do, that's play. Right. And any of us who care about child development will say, no, play is actually sometimes a struggle. Play is figuring stuff out when it's not working so well. Play is thinking about the other person's thoughts right. and building your behavior off of them. So just to answer that question about how much are kids playing the different types of apps, we just published a study 2 weeks ago about advertising in children's apps, yeah. where we analyzed 39 apps that we had captured on parents' mobile devices using those tracking apps, and then 96 apps that we downloaded from the Google Play designed for families 5 and under category. And so at least from that 39, we were able to see, it wasn't a representative sample, sure. right? It was a sample that we got from our research registry at University of Michigan. But we were able to see on some families' devices, there's PBS Kids and there's Netflix. And then on other families' devices, there are 10 different free apps
oh, yeah.
that are each played. So I'm curious, not only how long are those played, but how much is the child rapidly switching from one to the other when things get too hard? Because that's about executive function and task persistence and that expectation of external reward, not internal reward. And then the ones that we analyzed from the Google Play 5 and under category, we were mostly just looking at advertising and how frequently those ads were distracting from the underlying learning goal. We also found, which is interesting, is when we looked at what permissions a lot of those apps requested, they were requesting things that children should have privacy protections against, like GPS, their location,
oh, yeah.
their contacts, and all these other ways of scraping data that free apps do. So that's a whole other conversation of like, are your children's apps actually taking inappropriate data that they shouldn't be, that's come up?
So we've talked a lot about the downsides because they're so obvious, at least to me, but there's got to be some benefits. So do we have any research that says these apps can be beneficial on X, Y, or Z? And part of the reason that I say this is based on studies I have not done or read, I still think that PBS has actually done a lot of benefit for kids in terms of sort of school readiness over the past couple of decades.
Yeah.
Do we have any of that same action on the app side?
Well, the best evidence is still that long-term longitudinal evidence from PBS shows or Sesame Street or like Mr. Rogers. They were just crafted so intentionally with the child in mind.
Right.
You know, they have developmental psychologists who are thinking about what's the right amount of content and pacing and how do I include some nuggets for the parents in there about like how to talk to your child about yep. a tough issue. So I love the things I watched as a kid. I also appreciate the fact that Sesame and PBS are willing to try to test their products
right.
to make sure that kids can actually learn a little self-control from Cookie Monster's Challenge app or something like that. In our AAP guidelines, we did specifically say, parents, if you're interested in getting quality products, go to PBS Kids, go to Sesame Workshop, because they're nonprofits. A lot of their apps are free. So we're helping to reduce the digital divide between families who are downloading a lot of free apps that aren't high
right.
quality. And go to Common Sense Media, also to look up app ratings.
Yeah.
They may not have evidence that those apps actually improve educational outcomes, but at least they've been vetted in
right.
some way.
And their gut check is of some
exactly.
value. But you said the magic words, digital divide. So
yeah.
I want to jump on that. So early on, doing some studies in a previous job on the digital divide, the earliest digital divide was, well, wealthier kids and white kids have more hardware, right? And software. So that's their advantage. And then everybody got hardware and software. Well, they have more broadband. Broadband's the key. That's the digital divide. And then after that, and this is also at the school level, right? These more advantaged schools, they have equal broadband or closer to equal, but the digital divide that appeared was that instruction in more advantaged schools was just computers for educational uses and not for, well, you're done your work, go play this game. In other schools that were less advantaged, they used it a lot as trash, supplemental trash sort of programming. Go back and play the 7-year-old computer game on the Department of HHS hand-me-down computer that we got that we can't upkeep. That's the digital
mm-hmm.
divide. So what's the digital divide in mobile? I mean, do we know what it is, or do we anticipate that there's a digital divide, and along what lines?
It's a quality divide. The ownership divide has certainly lessened. There are still a lot of low-income families that are mobile only,
right.
that don't have laptops or other
right.
hardware at home. And they may be using their mobile phone for absolutely everything, including child stuff. The quality divide, I think, has to do with the availability of free apps that have no input from anyone who knows anything about childhood, right. Or some of them may be based on some basic curriculum. That's fine, but there's lots of ads or there's lots of distracting features. Those are free. Then there are apps that you can pay for that we've been starting to analyze in a content analysis in my lab. And some of them are lovely. They're all these like open-ended inventions that you can create, but right. You have to pay $3.99 for that. So there's a divide in terms of the quality of the experience while you're playing an app. Are you playing something that's open-ended and is going to challenge your mind a little bit? Or are you playing something that's closed loop and just, you know, kind of rote memory skills?
And it's fascinating here. What is the value between a truly educational game that your child will spend a lot of time on or a free game that is completely vacuous? I don't know what it is, but parents, I assure you it is more than $4. So spend the $4, right? I mean, it's just this amazing conditioning that happens when something is free. We just go to free instead of spending $4, although we may spend $60 an hour on tutoring in a couple of years. It just seems crazy.
Yeah, and I think that it's hard to know the value of different apps because kids may play them for months and months. They may play them for a day and be sick of it. And so some parents want those free apps so that they can at least test drive them and decide if they want to upgrade to the full version, which is fair enough.
Right.
But the free apps shouldn't be a vehicle for all of this either data scraping or behavioral ad targeting or other things. I mean, in our advertising content analysis, we saw ads popping up for inappropriate apps, like apps that were clearly for adults or they were like shooter racing car games, you know. So there's that. The other quality divide, I think, also has to do with the amount of brain space that parents have for being a digital mentor for their kids, right? That was one concept we brought up in our AAP guidelines, is that children are going to learn from you, parents. They're going to learn by watching you. They're going to learn by the fact that you need to be open to conversations with them about hard stuff, about weird stuff they're going to see online, about weird interactions they're going to have online. Start having open communication early and have a critical awareness of what you're seeing and consuming online, and really try to be proactive about making your media experiences matter and making them something that's going to help your family as a whole. I think when you are a stressed out parent and you barely have enough brain space to like get dinner on the table, afford the housing that you're in, deal with your abusive ex-boyfriend, all the other things that fill up parents' heads, being a digital media mentor is not one of the priorities.
Yeah, sure. It's tough. So I assume that you don't have data on this. So let me just ask you what you're afraid that screens are displacing. What are they moving, both between parents and their children, but also in their children's day-to-day life? I mean, are they just not out on the trampoline? Are they not raking leaves? What gets displaced?
All those things. But I mean, sleep, particularly conversations. But when I think about screen time, I have a hard time thinking about it as a researcher, because it's easy to measure, but it's not really capturing all the ways that screen media use is kind of pervading all the ins and outs and boring times of our day.
Right.
And so when I think about displacement, I think about, okay, when you are driving in the car and you're staring out the window and you have that like piece of brain downtime, those are times that your brain reorganizes itself. And you're just looking at visual patterns, looking out the window, you may be daydreaming. Those are important brain downtimes for kids. We don't yet have research. I'm actually working on an analysis right now, looking at when you're using media during all those little boring downtimes of the day, is that actually worse for kids' executive functioning or self-regulation?
I think that must be it. Just to pile on here, conversation is a two-way street, and parents are going to come back at some point and say, hey, we need to actually have a conversation. I haven't talked to you in 3 hours. But boredom has no advocate. And if it is good for kids to be bored, and I think it is the font of creativity, then the displacement of boredom can really be a problem, and we'll never see it because, again, you know, there's no advocate for boredom.
Mm. And there's also no advocate for distress tolerance, you know, other than a therapist, right? In clinic all the time, I'm seeing a distressed toddler or preschooler who, you know, maybe traumatized, maybe has some wiring different, that they're developing ADHD.
Right.
They're just harder to parent. They may have a parent with the same wiring or the same traumatic experiences. And so when your child is experiencing distress and you yourself have emotional either overreactivity or blunting, it can be really hard to tolerate their distress and to teach them how to tolerate and manage their distress. So that's where my concern about using mobile devices as a soothing tool, both for yourself as a parent to escape your difficult child, which we do have research evidence to show that parents who rate their children as really difficult are more likely to use technology during parent-child activities.
Yeah, I bet. So this is a schools podcast, and this totally counts because kids go to school. But for school leaders and people that are running schools and trying to figure out how do we use technology, are there any principles that educators need to just focus in on when they're thinking about how do we use technology in schools for kids?
I think it's important to have an intentional curriculum that might be a digital literacy curriculum, like, you know, Common Sense Education has, or other groups have been forming these sorts of ways of kids learning digital citizenship, kids learning about cyberbullying and learning about misinformation and how to really critically create some distance between you and the media that's coming at you, and not just falling for it every time, but also saying, wait, why am I reacting to it this way? And maybe I should pause and think about it before I tweet the next thing. So those are really important. It's really hard for young kids to get that because they don't have the cognitive skills or the self-awareness or the critical thinking to have that awareness about media. So in the early years, it's really important for parents really just to role model that and to even talk through their media experiences out loud, where I may say, oh my gosh, I just got this really stressful email. Oh, I feel so tense right now. What should I do? And I mean, I don't constantly narrate my inner state for my kids, but like there's a degree of talk out louds that we can do about media. We can't see each other's screens, right? And we can't see each other's internal reactions to our screens, but it might help our kids if we lay it out for them about everybody has these reactions and everybody feels an impulse to reply right away and say something angry. Schools should also take stock of when and how media is being used. And if there are examples of those like throwaway moments where you're like, well, the kids are bored, we're just using it as a reinforcer every time, I would like them to question that and to build either better alternatives to those things. I've seen in my own kids' school, my son would come home talking about playing friv.com. Do you know what Friv is? It's free video games. Look it up.
Excellent.
It's so exciting. And there's all these free video games on it, and that they were given that as a reward or something to do during indoor recess. And a lot of parents were upset because they kind of didn't want their kids getting into digital gaming yet because it's just so thrilling. And compared to the other academic work that the kids needed to do, some kids were having transition difficulties off of that.
It's a gateway drug to like PS3 is what it is.
God, I don't know. I'm glad we're not using it this year. I also volunteered at our media center at our local elementary school. And I loved that the librarian was totally open to me doing it. She knew that my background's in media. And we just had a great conversation about like where she could find resources and what to do when malware was clearly like infecting their laptops and like creating pop-ups. And I think it's really hard to keep updated on all the things you need to do. Teachers have so much on their plates otherwise. I mean, you know this better than I do. And administrators have so much to keep up with that technology just feels like one extra thing.
Yeah, one extra thing. Well, it is here to stay, and we're glad that you're keeping an eye on it for us. And Jenny Radesky, thanks for coming on the report card.
Yeah, thank you.
Jenny Radesky made a compelling case for limiting children's screen time and managing it appropriately. The question is whether parents' screen time is an even bigger problem for kids. To discuss this, we talk with Erika Christakis, author of The Importance of Being Little, What Young Children Really Need from Grownups. Erika Christakis, thank you for coming on the report card.
Well, thank you very much for having me.
Erika, to start off, I'd like to get your take on the American Academy of Pediatrics guidelines. And they're not really limits that they put out for kids' screen time use. They're guidelines. A lot of them are soft. In fact, the only sort of firm guidelines are to avoid digital media for toddlers younger than 18 to 24 months, and older than that but younger than 5, to limit it to just an hour a day of high-quality program. Those are interesting guidelines, but not a lot of hard and fast rules. So I wanted to get your take on those guidelines to start us off.
Sure. Well, you know, one of the things I really like about the guidelines is the focus on the relational aspect of family time, screen exposure. And so there's sort of a clear guideline that to the extent possible, families, caregivers should really be engaging with children when they are exposed to screen time. Now, the problem with this guideline is that so often we as parents use screen time as a way to buy ourselves some free time. So there's a little bit of a tension in there, but I do like the fact that there's a focus on creating a family plan and really talking about what the screen time looks like, and then finding ways to engage children so that they're not plugged into a screen by themselves alone.
So as far as what these guidelines are trying to help us avoid, I mean, there's different visions for what the problem is with kids and screen time, particularly young kids.
Right.
So it could be hard and fast demonstrable problems like developmental delays or problems with executive function. I mean, are those the main dangers as you see them, or is there a wider range of concerns that we should be concerned about?
So that's a really good question. I mean, I think there are two issues here. You know, one is sort of, what is the evidence for direct effects of children, you know, using screen time? And there is evidence of different types, but there are many great scientists doing research in this field and looking at, you know, how screen use may or may not affect children's brains and their attention and the way that they process reality is obviously very different than with grown-ups. And so then there's what I would call the opportunity cost of screen time, and that's a little different. It's not so much that there's a direct effect, but there is this choice between, you know, does your child go outside to play? Do they spend time with grandma or mom and dad, or are they plugged into a screen? And those effects are also, I think, quite important to look at. So those are the effects that we look at with kids. There's an essential process between a caregiver, and I'll just say parent for lack of a better word.
Sure. But,
you know, a trusted adult with whom a child has a true attachment. You know, there is an ancient emotional cueing system that builds brain development and literally builds neurons. And that is that serve and response, or that sort of conversational duet that different scientists have called, which is what goes on between a parent and a child. It starts at birth, or even arguably before birth, where a parent is beginning to learn to recognize and respond to emotional cues kids are giving. And that responsiveness then in turn gives the child a sense of patterns and familiarity, a sense of reassurance and comfort, and that helps build the architecture of the brain.
And just to make this simple, Erika, for our listeners,
yes,
who may be intimidated, we're just talking about conversing, like two human beings in face-to-face
literally
conversation.
We're talking about conversation. I mean, to me, it is, I've called it, you know, it's like gold. I mean, it's more valuable than almost any other brain development system we have. Several years ago, there was a big meta-analysis of a number of literacy programs for preschool, or something like 13 or 15 of them, and they were all found to be basically ineffective. But we do have one highly effective system for building brain architecture, for building language skills, cognitive skills, self-regulation skills, emotional development, and it's conversation between loving caregivers and their children. And actually, I would even use the word conversation more loosely, because it really starts in infancy, you know, when a baby cries and the parent responds to the cry. And, you know, even when you look at sort of the biology of breastfeeding, for example, or just feeding a child even from a bottle, you know, there's a sort of cueing system that goes on that is often not verbal.
Well, yeah, certainly, Erika, there's this back and forth sort of full sense of conversation is valuable, but we certainly know that if screen time is displacing that, that screens can't duplicate that sort of holistic view of this back and forth conversation and cueing, right?
That's right. And I think we all sort of know this intuitively, not only from some of the studies we've read, but just we know how frustrating and irritating it can be when someone interrupts us when we're plugged into our own devices. You know, there's a kind of almost addictive response where people get a bit irritable and fussy when they're interrupted. And so you can imagine how a parent who is on a screen, on a smartphone, for example, might either miss cues or actually ignore them or misinterpret them from a child. And actually, in a laboratory setting, researchers have looked at this question. A scientist named Kathy Hirsch-Pasek in Philadelphia actually brought mothers into a laboratory setting with their toddlers. I'd just like to say that it always seems to be mothers who are subjected to these kinds of studies. But in any event, and she gave, you know, she had a group that were given cell phones, and the babies and another group that didn't have cell phones, the mothers were told to teach their toddler a made-up word, two made-up words. And the mothers who were interrupted by a cell phone, it was found that their toddlers were not able to learn these fictitious words, whereas the babies who weren't interrupted were able to learn them. I mean, that's a very neat little study that just illustrates sort of what we're talking about, which is that when you interrupt this ancient and time-tested and really valuable cueing system, you can have problems. You know, I think most parents sort of cringe and think, oh my God, how am I going to live my own life if, you know, I can't even tune out for a second? And I think that the point is that you can tune out, but you just have to structure your life so that when you are with your child, you need to be responsive. But I don't think, I'm certainly not suggesting that parents need to sacrifice their entire existence to their offspring. You know, I think this generation of parents is probably working harder to be great parents than almost any generation in history. But there is something about this idea that when you're with your child, you should be more tuned in.
That certainly makes sense. I'll tell you the sort of sinister nature, if I can play the devil's advocate against the good screen time, or for folks who would say that, you know, there's some good things for screen time. The sinister right. thing about these screens is that they sort of sneak in slowly. It is not like we make yes. decisions to, you know, I'll check Twitter 48 times today. That's what I want to do. You just kind of keep getting it. And of course, these companies make these incredibly well-designed apps and devices to hold our attention. So we talk about how these things can go badly and how they can go well, but I certainly have my view. My question for you is, do you think that we are having net damages from this, or do you think that we're coping with these rapid changes in how both kids and parents act in a way that, you know, has benefits for kids?
My gut reaction is that I think we're probably doing some damage, but I want to sort of modify that statement a little bit. I think there's always a temptation to look at the current generation of children and to sort of assume that everything is going to hell in a handbasket and that in the old days everything was better, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, there is this kind of kids these days, and I put that in quotations, feel to some of the critique, you know, and obviously people were complaining about the impact of the telephone on children, you know, back in the early 1900s. All that said, I do think we're in new territory, even since the introduction of smartphones, which I don't know, what was that, like 2007 or 8 or something like that?
Yes, not that long ago, right?
Not that long ago, but it's interesting that there is a real sort of shift. And I think in terms of the impact on kids, I guess I would say a couple of things. You know, I do think children are very resilient as a species. You know, children have to learn to be, we've all, as humans, we're quite adaptable. I also think kids are very good at sort of demanding time from parents when they need it. That said, we are in uncharted territory with this interruption of this queuing system. And I think it's sort of coupled. Here's what I think is sort of sociologically interesting and maybe scary. Parents today are spending more time with their children. It's not face-to-face, let's say side-by-side contact. They're physically present, let's say, in the same room with their children much more than parents of previous generations, even when you control for entry into the workforce of mothers and so on. So if you're comparing, you know, working parents today and parents who didn't have jobs outside the home in previous generations, you know, today's parents are still really, really physically present with their kids. But I think it's fair to say that they're not emotionally attuned to the same extent, because so much of that time that they're physically present is spent looking at a screen or kind of just checking back and forth. And like you said, it's not intentional. I mean, none of us set out to be unresponsive parents. So I think that's tricky, because you can sort of argue that, as I have, that kids are getting actually the worst of all worlds, in that they're not getting as much independent time, you know, with free play and with mixed generational play where adults are not sort of hovering and butting in. There's a lot less of that sort of experience. But then when they are with their parents, they're not necessarily getting that really attuned experience. So, you know, to me, the solution is parents should give themselves permission to spend less time with their kids. But when they are with them, they need to really, you know, shut down the devices. Easier said than done.
Certainly easier said than done. But I'd like to contrast this. When I was a kid, there was a big concern about television. Television was taking over. And, right. you know, it was just baking kids' brains because they were on television. Still today, kids do a lot of their screen time on television and video. And I think that a lot of the concerns that were at play in the late 80s and the 90s about television have sort of been, you know, digested, and it's sort of the new normal. I worry that the new kinds of screen time are similarly available as TV and video is, but just it's the interruptiveness, right? It is the fact that we can take a dose of TV in half-hour increments, which makes it a little bulky. to take on, but we can take Twitter in every 30 seconds. And, you know, that's mea right. culpa here as a dad of three yeah. kids. I find myself, you know, itching to just kind of, you know, grab it for just a second. It's not going to interrupt my child rearing, but it does.
First of all, it's really easy to lose track, like you said, of, you know, quantifying, like, actually, how much time are we spending? But it's also this phrase that a technology expert, I think she called it continuous partial attention or constant partial attention.
Right.
But, you know, it sort of speaks for itself. I mean, this idea that we're, you know, we're always on, but not really completely engaged. And I think young kids really tune into that. And I also think you have to look at what's going on in schools and the amount of screen exposure that young kids have. I'll speak for young children, including in daycares. One study that actually was done by my brother-in-law, who's an expert in children and media, youth, Dimitri Christakis, he looked at a study of children's exposure to screen time and found that it was actually much higher than in some previous studies because they actually factored in kids' exposure during daycare hours.
That's a good question. So I know that you are focused on early education. I don't want to ask you about the full range of schooling, but there's certainly a connection between what happens at home and what schools and teachers face when kids get to school. And this is both about sort of school readiness, but also, you know, later on, because, you know, third graders, well, they still go home and they have opportunities to do lots of things, including excessive screen time. What are the implications of the current screen time practices that we have at home that might play out in schools?
Well, I think let's start with early education, and then maybe we can move up the ladder a bit. You know, we know that conversation and children who have a secure attachment to an adult, we know that these things build the brain in all kinds of important ways, cognitively and emotionally. One of the trends that we see in early childhood classrooms, and I'm referring to daycare, preschool, and kindergarten, we see a lot more scripted language, a lot more scripted curriculum, a lot less flexibility and emotional responsiveness in classrooms than in prior generations when kids had fewer expectations placed on them to, for example, learn to read by the end of kindergarten. Just to give you a little bit of context, I think it was in the 1980s, you know, the vast majority of first grade teachers did not think that children needed to have learned to read before entering first grade. Now, the vast majority, and when I think it's around 80%, say that they should be reading by the time they come to first grade. So, you know, we've changed the expectations of children while at the same time we're sort of tying their hands behind their back because we're not giving them what they actually need to succeed, which is this rich, emotionally responsive, conversational sort of experience. So I think where that comes in with the screen time and this homeschool connection is that we cannot assume as teachers that kids are getting that at home. The emotionally rich conversations, the open-ended free. You know, as an FYI, kids tend to spend more time in rich imaginative talk, self-talk, when they're playing with blocks than in front of a screen.
Well, that certainly makes sense. I mean, so let me restate back to you what I've heard. It sounds like what you're saying is if screen time is dominating certain students' home lives, and it interrupts the sort of conversational needs that they have, these developmental cueing systems. And then if they go to schools where things are sort of more systematized or scripted and less sort of conversation-based and open-ended and imagination-based, then we may actually be keeping kids from another chance to develop what some may not be getting at home.
That's right. And then I would throw in another factor here, which is we're sort of talking in this generic way about kids, but actually there are a huge number of kids who are really at risk for various reasons. You know, we're paying more attention in the child development field to what are known as adverse childhood experiences. And it can be anything from the death of a parent or a parent with a substance abuse problem. Very large numbers of kids have these adverse childhood experiences. I think 50% have at least one. And 12% have three or more. You know, these are children who need more emotional connection, more responsive conversation, more opportunities to listen and to be heard, not fewer. And so I think sometimes schools, and I say this as a former teacher myself, you know, we have this tendency to look to technology for these fixes. And, you know, every year you get some new curriculum or some new device or gadget or whatever that's going to make learning so much better. But when you're talking about early childhood development in those early years, there's nothing really more efficient than just a great, responsive, adult who expresses interest in a child. And that turns out to be this sort of magic elixir, I think, for child development, for healthy development, cognitive and academic, as well as social and emotional.
Erika Christakis, thanks for coming and talking about screen time and kids' health on The Report Card.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thanks for listening to this episode of The Report Card with me, Nat Malkus. And special thanks to our guests, Jenny Radesky and Erika Christakis. If you enjoyed this episode, take a minute and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, or your favorite podcast player. And don't forget to rate us and review us on iTunes or Google. If you have comments, questions, or topic suggestions for future episodes, drop us a line at ed.podcast@aei.org. And until next time, I'm Nat Malkus.